all the massive ideas that pass our head in any given moment, flash of ideas. One I was thinking of today as I was driving down here was the huge difference between value and price. A banker was in my house today and we're talking about various things, and he says, "I like the paintings on your wall." He said, "Have you insured them?"
The micro piece.
I said, he said to me, "Have you insured the paintings?" I said, "I can't insure them." He said, "Why?" I said, "Because they have a great deal of value, but no price." I said, "These paintings are made by my mother. And my mother never exhibited once and never sold anything. So if I were to take one of her paintings and go down to Monastiraki and try and sell it, I doubt if I would get €1. But huge amount of value, you know." So you can go on the internet and look up any poet. They're almost all there. All the famous poets there. Every line that Shakespeare has ever written on the internet that you get for free. You know. Reading them, you get, I mean, what a treasure trove. What an incredible amount of value you're getting. It doesn't cost you anything. Some of the most valuable things in life are free. Just think of the air that you're breathing. You know. It's the most valuable thing for you. You wouldn't exist without it. Costs you nothing. So poetry, in a way, has to do with value, what it gives us, you know. One usually doesn't find bankers and people involved in finances thinking of value in terms of anything else but price. When they say, "What is the value of the stock?" they're talking about the price of the stock. They're saying, is it $152 per share? Is it $12 per share? Is it going down in value? Is it going down in price? Nothing to do with the value of it. You know. Does it have value or not? The dean of Harvard Law School, in addressing his graduates, and most of these graduates would go on to get very big salaries, and a lot of them go on for very prestigious positions that paid a lot of money. And he said, "You must remember," he said, "that you must never forget to continue reading poetry." He said, "Think of it like a swimmer, you know, in the sea, you know, with his head down doing the crawl. Every few minutes he has to lift up his head to get some oxygen and then go down again." He said, "Well, poetry is like that. It's the oxygen of life. It gives you this awareness that you don't get from anything else." Over the last 45 years, we've had many poets here. And a lot of the poets themselves have been more interesting than their poetry. And sometimes a lot of the poetry was more interesting than the poets, you know. And I always found this juxtaposition very interesting. Some of the poets were really outrageously eccentric, you know, amusing, funny, and some of them were outrageously serious. But they all contributed one thing. They all contributed something that made our life more valuable. I'd like to thank our guests here this evening, Lee Slonimsky. Especially I'd like to thank him because this is not the first, it's not the first time he has come here and read, which is an honor for us. And because he worked in money and banking for many years, it's even more interesting for me and more interesting for you to be able to see his viewpoints. And Ginger Zaimis, who will also read from a collection of poetry. And I'd like to thank all of you for coming here this evening. I recognize most of you poets included, former teachers here at the Athens Center from many years ago, more guests arriving for poetry. I mean, I find it really impressive that if you look this evening in a magazine called Athenorama or What's Going On This Evening, there's lots of things going on in Athens. You know, there's movies, there's theater productions, there's other events, there's book presentations, there's marches on the street. So you have a choice. I'd like to congratulate you on your choice this evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, John. I'd like to thank you all, John Zervos, Rosemary Donnelly at the Athens Center and the team, and all of you who came out tonight to hear the oxygen of life, as John said. That's a good quote, I like it. Very honored to be here, very honored to be reading with Lee Slonimsky. He's a fascinating poet, polymath, and a friend of Pythagoras. And Lee and I share this connections with the city, New York and Athens, as you might have deduced from the title on the reading tonight. Myself, having lived in New York for many years, now in Athens, Lee currently lives in New York. He's visiting to Athens. He's a friend of Greece. We're very, very grateful to have him here. But also, I think more importantly, Lee's work and part of my work really talk about cosmopolitanism and pluralism from a Hellenistic perspective. You know, a bit what we saw from Hellenistic Alexandria. And so there's that interweaving of philosophy. You know, there's like layers of architecture, of thought, idea that has been kind of looked at and reviewed and regurgitated throughout the age. And tonight we're going to start with, we're both going to talk about philosophy from a different yet similar perspective. And I'm going to talk about poetry and philosophy and form. And well, anyway, I'm an advocate of formalism myself, but I do like to experiment with various forms, being also an advocate of architecture and seeing the world through those particular lenses. So I'm going to start with it is a pantoum from my first collection. It was it's entitled. It talks about Aristotle. It really is perhaps a tribute to him in his rhetoric of poetry. So, the A principles. Platonically put, as per him, the cloth or string of rhetoric, are tragedy and comedy then, like the nature of poetics, the cloth or string of rhetoric, language, rhyme, and melody, like the nature of poetics, matter, subject, and or method. Language, rhyme, and melody. Impartial thought to carry a plot. Matter, subject, and or method. As diction, character, a biased lot. Impartial thought to carry a plot. Are tragedy and comedy them? As diction, character, a biased lot, platonically put. As for him. So, I'd like to talk about a new form, not so new, but new-ish. And it was really inspired by looking at the face of an ancient temple. And using classical archetypes to, you know, reinvent the old to the new. I played with the idea of really using sound, silent sound, as you would see like a Doric, the Doric columns in front of a portico or the porch of an ancient temple. And so the rhyme ebbs and flows with the sound, silence, sound. So it's called the portico. And it can be read horizontally as well as vertically, very, very similar to the echo, the ancient echo. It's poetry's new intervention. Vitruvian theory, like Bridges convention, based upon the numbers 1.6, the golden ratio with mixed strategy or mean, structural entrance, a design scheme to write a sentence, an arrangement of words to coerce, architecture hereof in rhythmic verse, with face colonnaded meter, iambic space via pedometer, tetrameter, harmonized by sound, silence, sound. Walls ally up from the ground. As the Montagues and Capulets, voiced as dual couplets. Meese, Wright, or Elizabeth Diller, to uphold high the six pillars. So to ride this wave of new form, I'm gonna read a few triptychs. And the literary triptych is a design form that I've experimented with in my latest collection, Prometheus Bound and Other Mythology. And basically, the triptych is very much what it sounds like. It is three parts of a poem, but it was inspired by the Homeric epigram, plus two lines. And as very rightly so, Alicia Stallings pointed out, it partakes a bit of the ancient haiku, which you aesthetically it seems quite akin. So, the triptych. Psyche and Soma, perhaps perceived as random, pure chance, the soul and the body at first glance, meaningful arrangements to advance. This next triptych, it partakes a bit of Aristotle's De Anima, and he talks about the source and the soul, and basically one, all is one. And so when looking at this text, you have this impression, specifically when he says all is one, and then he very, very immediately very specifically states after that the one is two, yet the two are one, and he specifically talks about one as well as the dimorgos or the dimorgi, one but two but one. So there's this circular reference, this philosophical circular dialogue in this next poem, Ouroboros. Connected from beginning to end, spherical, like serpent with mouth injected tail, visceral, infinite wisdom, and union of two to one eternal. So the last triptych, it's entitled Words Lyre, and lyre like the instrument, the little flute. And I think sometimes we forget how powerful words are, and that really words are energy, and depending on how you wield them or do not, you can do many things with them. In fact, you can pretty much do anything. But it really depends on how you shape them, how you create them. So, words lyre. The sound stung her ears as it severed past. Words, their impact made upon contact. The impression left, a wound to last. So, I'm going to close my portion of the reading with a sonnet cycle, and it's actually a part of a book which I co-authored with a colleague of mine, Evangelos Moutsopoulos, who's an esteemed member of the Academy as well as the philosopher of Charicity. And I had the honor to work with him and have this dialogue, this kind of, you know, philosophical poetic dialogue. The book's called Philosophy and Poetry, and his portion of the book basically talks about creating in the shadow of the divine, and it basically references from, you know, Greek, ancient Greece up to present, from, you know, Sophocles, Anagoraxos, Heraclitus, Plato, Socrates, Aristotle, Stottle in Proclus, and he references basically the theory of creating or co-creating in the shadow of the divine, as we all do, in some way, shape, or form. And my part of the contribution was basically a poetic one, the creation. And so I wanted to somehow interweave and unite what he was talking about, which is very much, as Heraclitus says, as above, so as below, into my creation. And so this sonnet cycle, it talks about Homer's epic, the Odyssey, and it basically weaves in hermetics. And so we deal with principles of oneness, gender, cause and effect. And in essence, I use Penelope or Odysseus and Penelope to depict this. So there's two poems, yet they're actually one. So there's this oneness, this two, yet this one in the end. So this Odyssepic. It's complicated getting back. After long journey that burns, life seems different on the round turn. Now you have vision, hindsight at last. It then becomes a big question of what is or is not the ending versus the genesis, the beginning. Philosophy, the circular vision, like the victory of the Trojan War, which in short was not the end, but rather a new wound to start your life anew. Years and years at sea, 10, wanting to want what you could not have, living to live for tomorrow, the good or bad. And do you ever in truth arrive back home as you left it, Ithaca? Has life changed you through your eyes as you cross vast seas north of Africa? Was it all just a grand illusion, like the beauty of a woman, Helen, who started all this to decide your fate and ours of Greece, alas? Or rather, was it man's greed for gold, and she the fair excuse that sold the idea that twisted your hand? Politics, honor, reason with a plan. And what would have become of you, Odysseus, if you never left home? Though the thought is indeed mute, unlike the satyr's lyre, his flute, because it did come to fruition, happen. And the what-if factor would only madden even the most sound man of mind. The philosoph's query is out of time. One must then earnestly ask, who is the real monster behind the mask? I suppose it is basic conjecture. The rhapsody of the past and future, a matter of simple perspective, as the sense of memory deceptive. Man's true nature cast aggressive, like you on life's edge, epic adventure. Penelope, her version. And how she waited all those years for mortal man, her husband, lover, wishing, weaving, only to discover that hope, desire would bring her tears. Odysseus, in truth, he was never near. Honor thronged him into the arms of war, and she became a distant image that tore at his memory. Heart, the poor dear. Shipwrecked, stranded at the feet of Circe, he warmed quick in her arms to mercy, then submitted to flesh their oneness. His carnal longing, the unquenchable thirst, though half parted his distrust, still he embraced her, this goddess. All the while the wine dark sea churned, for you, Penelope, your days passed slow like time stopped at bay. As you thumbed clock's page turned, moments shaped nights one by one, wondering, dreaming of him, hope that he was alive and would soon return home. It was your lifeline, this tethered rope, but he had been brought to Calypso's shores, pulled from Poseidon's grip the sea, captive lover, nymph, someone's whore. Tell me, Odysseus, what is your real need? Is it Ithaca or burning passion on board? Life's lust for adrenaline, don't you see? And when you do arrive back home, embrace your wife, fathom her in bed, what memories linger like demons in your head? Are the souls still one, or are they alone? It's hard getting back on the round turn. Ghosts whisper from past's present burn. Time's passage of 20, all those years. Wounded flesh, scars, still they sear. Yet see the division of your life now. It is in flux, a basic conundrum of how. If you want to be free from the water god's curse, leave again, retreat inland to the psyche traverse, and sacrifice truth, your ego, pride for peace. Only then an untroubled spirit you will keep. Thank you. I would now very much like to introduce Lee Slonimsky, very talented poet. Very, very pleased to have him here, polymath. I would even go so far to say Lee's knowledge of Pythagoras is really exceptional. I mean, he's done research for the last 15 years. He has 6 collections in print. We're going to hear a bit of that from Lee tonight. So I'd like to bring Lee forward and let him talk about all of this great stuff that he's got for us tonight.
Thank you, Ginger, for that's a beautiful reading. And thanks also, Rosemary, for your review. Well-known poets as teachers, but this was a really extraordinary workshop. And then I came back in 2013 to do a talk on the financial crisis, which I know is hard to put into 1 year at this point, unfortunately, but that was certainly turbulent times, which, you know, maybe are improving a little bit now. And then, this is my third trip, and it's been great every time I've been here. I feel like this place, the Athens Center, has some tremendous spirit of poetry to it. A lot of really distinctive and famous poets. As John Zervos said in his really, really supportive introduction, you know, this is just a place I think is kind of on the map, you know, globally speaking, for the culture, you know, that it preserves, and also that it has really done a lot with, even, you know, in contemporary times. So it's really actually very moving to be back here. So I'm going to read mostly maybe a half dozen poems or so from my new, I shouldn't say my, it's our new collection. The translator into French is Elizabeth J. Coleman, who is a really outstanding poet and also vice president of the Poetry Society of America, and who worked for years on doing these translations. There's only 46 poems in the book, but you know, it took actually probably over 18 months to even do the first drafts. I mean, she worked very hard on it. As many have pointed out since the book was published, she's not French herself, but I believe that translation can allow for many different permutations of origin and language and so forth. So here's two Americans, you know, fumbling around, but it is a bilingual French-English book. And proudly has a cover comment from Rachel Hadas, who's, you know, as good a judge of poetry as anyone. And so I'm going to read several from that book, and then I have a few other of my books. I'm just going to read one poem from each. And I will also announce at this point that my wife, who is a very accomplished poet and novelist, Carol Goodman, she's only had one poem in a book, actually, which is in my second book, which is also distinguished for having been at the printer for 5 years while the publisher worked its way through bankruptcy, which is not a unique accomplishment in American poetry for any of you who might be familiar with it. So, but anyway, she's that poem, The Sycamores of Rome, which is, you know, kind of in a way, when I read it originally several years ago, very much reminded me of Greece, and as you'll see. So she's also going to read that as part of my very quick survey as Ginger was nice enough to point out. I published 6 books, and chronologically in terms of when they were actually published as opposed to when a publisher cleared bankruptcy. The second was Pythagoras in Love, which is this is the translation of, and then that was followed by a book called Logician of the Wind, which is predominantly poems about Pythagoras. And then he continues to appear as a character or historical figure in the poems that came from, in the books that came afterwards. Let me just say a word, and I don't want to talk more than this, but I'll do this very concisely. I had started writing in form, particularly sonnets, in the year 2000, and in 2002 I was out walking, which is still my method for writing most of my poems, and I decided, rather than writing an Elizabethan sonnet that day, that I wanted to try a Petrarchan one. But I misremembered Petrarch's name as Pythagoras and thought to myself, let me write a Pythagorean sonnet. And as sure as I'm standing here, this is the great, you know, intellectual achievement where I entered into, it was actually a mistake, which probably not as memorable as Einstein tripping getting off the bus, which is sometimes where relativity is said to have come from. But anyway, it's my mistake, so I'm sharing it. And I later found out about 7 years later that the historical figure Petrarch, the poet, actually had his own narrative with Pythagoras. I mean, he actually wrote an essay in the 12th century, I think, in southwest France, where he was in exile, southeast France. And there's actually quite a bit of commentary that has been unearthed, not just from this essay, but also from letters that indicate. Now, Petrarch's reasons for being really, very much influenced by Pythagoras are interesting in that the poetic reasons are kind of parallel. I mean, he was very attracted to a world based on number in terms of his own interest in the math that lies behind poetic form. But I just, when I'm in need of something to cheer me up, I think about how the misremembered, Petrarchan sonnet was influenced by someone who was also interested in the historical Pythagoras. And on that point, I just want to say briefly in terms of the philosophy that, you know, Ginger was very adroitly alluding to in her reading. Pythagoras's main historical beliefs that have influenced me as a poet are, first, the intelligence of nature and the intelligence of animals and the mathematical abilities of both, okay? It comes very close to an idea that is currently in the world, which you could divide between philosophy and also physics, that the actual numerical structure of the universe is fundamentally the meaning and the reality of it, and of course everything that you can find a corresponding number for anything. I mean, the chairs in this room, the number of molecules in everyone sitting here, and so on and so forth. But that was a doctrine that said that that's not an aspect of things, but that is the central nature of things. And for that reason, or partly inspired by that, I've written a lot of poems about the intelligence of nature and the intelligence of animals, metaphorically. I mean, I use that as sort of a central metaphor in my work. And the other aspect of Pythagorean thought had to do with just a kind of unity that comes out of this sense of number, that because numbers are kind of a universal language among not only the human intellect, but also among literally all matter, like rocks. I mean, to Pythagoras, rocks were mathematicians. And that's about as inert a piece of existence as probably any of us could think of. So he saw a rock as having an active mathematical narrative. And even though that is, from our point of view, really seems like it's metaphor, there's actually science that supports, which I'm not an expert and we don't have the time for it, but it is interesting that's actually going on in the world today. So those were kind of the aspects of Pythagoras that I tried to tie together in my own work. So let me begin with a few poems from Pythagoras in Love. I'll read the first poem in the book, which is called The Last Digit of Pi. Bisected by a tree, the sun's gold light draws angles on the glass skin of the pond. Dawn's revelers, a pair of geese in flight, soar high above the wooded hill, beyond Pythagoras' line of sight. And now he's all alone, high priest of water, sky, intuitor of theorems, teller how this world's the weave of math, the art of pi. Another pair of geese approach and glide across the water. Near the grove of trees he sits beneath. Blind shadows try to hide amidst the ripples wrinkled by a breeze. The last of pies that stealthy, he decides, elusive as the wind this dawn light rides. A crow's point of view. His morning walk reveals geometry and how the sunlight angles through the trees and intersects the mists that wreathe the pond. A loud crow lectures oak leaves just beyond his line of sight on how a dappled breeze confuses light. And yes, he must agree that shadows lie, that rippling branches tease false theorems from the axes of sun's rays. And yet, when air is still, the water gleams with trapezoids and ellipses. Sunbeams seem shining summaries of all the ways to measure surfaces. Dangling oak leaves and pond instruct him well in ray-seamed math, his new academy a woodland path. These are all sonnets, by the way, and many of them. I mean, they're two commonest forms of the sonnet in Western culture are the Elizabethan and the Petrarchan. But actually, quite a few of these are hybrid forms, which I could claim creativity for, or I could say it's easier, you know, to jump the rules here and there if you want to get everything. You know, these poems, they have their ups and downs, but in most cases, I am trying to get some at least observation, you know, into the poem, which contradicts some aesthetics about poetry. But as, again, as Ginger said, I'm personally a very strong believer in that much as poetry has struggles with its audience nowadays, philosophy, I mean, the traditional philosophy in Pythagoras' time was a major concern, like what was going on in the stock market or in military conflicts. It really was in that culture. It's amazing. But now when you look at contemporary, even going back to philosophers like Heidegger, politics aside, and others, I mean, nobody reads them. I mean, their challenges in a public space are even more severe than poetry. So why not take these two, you know, wandering, forlorn disciplines, which is so important in world history, and put them both in a poem? I mean, it wasn't a conscious decision to do that, but I do think that philosophical modern philosophy survives in poetry, actually. And of course, you know, in fiction too. So this is another's eyes. Pythagoras recalls how, as a tree, he learned that math predicts both sun and shade. Perceived the numbers that the gods had made to count the twigs and branches draped with leaves. Such longing he felt then to know how free the birds were in their flight, light in the glade, while stillness was the god that he obeyed, and silent green of leaves his destiny. He walks now as a man in just the woods he lived in as an oak 100 years, no longer with that lust to move, speak, cry, but thinking that he'd welcome if he could another life now as a fox or a deer, the revolution of another's eyes. This poem, I'm just mentioning this sort of in passing. This poem was published in the Carolina Quarterly around 2005. I sent these poems out quite a bit to journals. I have had some luck with them, but I will say that in every time when I knew what the circumstances were of the editor who accepted one of these poems, there was always some connection to the nature of these poems. I mean, at the Carolina Quarterly, the editor at the time was getting a PhD in Elizabethan literature. So, you know, the receptivity of the sonnet was probably part of it, and I had some others in journals that are kind of known, but I did find the best reception, you know, in those few journals, like the Formalist or Measure, that specifically, or if they don't emphasize the sonnet, they certainly emphasize formal verse. Reassured by a hawk. Vicissitudes of cloud have broken rain and lightning over every inch of path. Though now the slosh of puddle faintly gleams in sun-split respite and placid silence soothes some spare survivors, thunder-flattened leaves still gasping for green air off slashed branches, sundered trunks of oaks are everywhere. He looks but can't believe the victory of sever in these woods presided over now by vacant sky and muted trill of lark. Such rule by chance sent fury frightens, theorems disappear to chaos in a world of garbled ruins. He's frantic for some order. Hawk ascends, then traces perfect circles based on pi. And the newest, not contemporary, but ancient source for Pythagoras, which is Iamblichus, that's the second century AD, and then really translated in the 1880s. That is a narrative that is much more full of the business of communicating with animals, being reincarnated as an animal, and a doctrine called metempsychosis, which is very similar to the Hindu doctrine of reincarnation without anything like a caste system. And that doctrine, which is by many descriptions, including Heraclitus, who was a contemporary of Pythagoras and either knew him or certainly knew of him and who hated him, that's politics. So anyway, in Heraclitus's case, Heraclitus wrote a fragment which survives, which suggested that Pythagoras's motivation was actually animals and that all the philosophy and, of course, the legendary mathematical skill, which historians totally repudiate. The Pythagorean theorem is found in Egyptian literature in the 8th century BC. So he clearly did not originate that. But it was used as an example of his mathematical astuteness. So I'm saying this because the poem I just read, it's very influenced by that historical trait, but I'm also someone who's always been very interested in animals and was writing about them in other forms, so I guess those two streams kind of just came together. Let me read just a couple more. This poem, Counting Toward the End. I wrote this poem in the ruins of the Roman Forum, where there is a bust of Pythagoras that survives. In the Roman Republic, Pythagoreans were a political party, and at one point had over 150 members. The bust is where they used to gather and essentially discuss strategy and so on while the Senate was meeting. And I was pretty stunned to see that, even though I'd read about it. So I then actually wrote this poem, which has nothing to do with what I just said, but I wrote it right afterwards. Counting Toward the End. A flood of sunlight drenches this lush lawn and splashes radiance on nearby trees. Pythagoras divides the summer dawn into the cosmos, multiplies by breeze and quality of drifting yellow light to calculate how many roses thrive within the boundary of his circling sight. His answer is 7, but he sees just one. It's scarlet shimmering in early sun. But faith in truth of math endures despite this failure. Now as mockingbirds arrive, their music theorem for math's harmonies, he calculates how long he might survive to stroll at dawn to count the shining leaves. Okay, and the last poem from the book. This is another situation where I wrote something without actually knowing the historical circumstances. Let me just fill in one final piece of background, which it's important to know just in terms of the general picture. Pythagoras was a really major figure beginning in the 5th century BC when, after his death, a philosopher named Philolaus wrote a book putting in writing the Pythagorean doctrine, because Pythagoras himself either never wrote anything or the writing was for there, and there are many possible reasons to believe that he might have written something that was destroyed. His political party's reign in Crotona in southern Italy ended really badly with arson, several murders of major party leaders, and he escaped and lived out his life in Metapontum further up the east coast of Italy. But in the fourth century, the written version of it by Philolaus became a hugely important book and was a major, if not the biggest, influence on Plato. And during that pre-Christian period, which I mentioned for a specific reason, those centuries, there was a political party that had actually originated in Crotona with a real rule, and that turns up in the Roman Senate. But it also became not exactly a religion or a cult, and that distinction, of course, is much more blurry then than it might be now. But it was an interest or a belief held by a large portion of the middle, what you could call, it's a not exact comparison, but the middle class population of Rome, and even in Greece, had a kind of Pythagorean belief system that was a rival to early Christianity. After Christianity begins to spread, you get a book called the Pythagorean Gospels, which was written by the Pythagoreans in the hope that they would ward off the trend towards Christianity, which of course they did not, and the early church saw Pythagoreanism and its history, other than in the aspect of music, as really threatening, and basically took a lot of steps to kind of stamp out that history. Although Pythagoras appears on the facade of the cathedral at Chartres in France, and also in much smaller Notre Dame. The French in particular, who still maintain a historical connection, and one of the reasons this book got translated into French, you know, they had a kind of liberal church movement around the 5th or 6th century that tried harder to preserve this. But essentially, during that whole long period of 500 or 600 years where this was, you know, effectively a major religion in the Mediterranean, people made or discovered all kinds of stories. And in this case, Pythagoras is said to have recalled a past life. And it was an unbelievable, I mean, I would compare it today to, again, I mean, it's really something on the level of what the world is preoccupied with at the moment, all these financial, geopolitical issues, was the question of whether if you are reincarnated, do you remember your past life? And they just have so much writing that survives on this point. I've read one estimate that it was actually 5% in the second century. It was actually 5% of all the subject matter that's been recovered was on this point. And it was always believed that, and claiming recall of past lives over the long run was very dangerous because it was really hard to believe. I mean, that might sound funny given what they did believe, but it actually did a lot of damage. It was ridiculed by, it was a critical point against Christianity. It was a critical point because Christianity was proposing a miracle that was the sole miracle, and actually it really had more psychological force than 10,000 miracles. I mean, Pythagoras had, you know, taught a bear to cuddle up with people and never attack them, and he had this famous one where he changed the bear's diet by talking to him. So I don't know how often that really happens. I actually don't believe any of it. But in any event, I'll let this poem speak for itself. It's called Epilogue Pacifist. Pythagoras remembers how he was the warrior Euphorbus slain at Troy, his bitterness defeated in the dust, his darkly blooming blood armor destroyed, his foe Atreides, so merciless in Trojan pride, face venomous and sour, with battle lust, inflicting his torment, devoid of mercy in the final hour. But now his world is green, soft breezes lush, he's been a tree almost 200 years, those fiendish memories drift into mist, his only enemy is lightning here. And sometimes he will dream in still twilight of warriors embracing, soothing sight. Okay, and then I have, as I said, I'm going to read just
a couple, and looking ahead, I'm going to close by something. I've actually never done this before, and it's really, it's an awful thing to do from all my experience as a poet, but I'm going to read a poem that I only wrote a couple of days ago, which is, you know, for someone like me who needs to look at a poem 2 years later to have any idea where to begin, it's dangerous and foolish, but it came up in conversation with Ginger yesterday, and it seems somehow, I mean, at least something you could listen to. So I'm going to read one poem from Logician of the Wind. It's called Horse, and it's really about the history of life, and then we'll listen to Carolyn also. I'll finish with the new one. Horse. A billion years ago or more, we split. One branch of DNA became the plants, the other animals, amoeba, ants. Eventually us with all our wars and wit. And so this gnarled old oak should not surprise its massive knot, a perfect horse's head. Such natural craftsmanship, both branches wed in a quaint sculpture, yet exact and wise in summary of science. But the snort you hear quite suddenly, the flapping of tails, unnerve, then stomp of hooves truly startles. It conjures wind and gallop, courage, heart. Whatever's in there yearns so to be free. You want to liberate it from this tree. Okay, and then I just want to introduce Carol's poem. I mean, Carol's a great writer, and she actually, in her teen years, and I believe the same year she was last in Greece, which was 1975, Lawrence Ferlinghetti, a poet many of you may know, author of, I believe this is true, Coney Island of the Mind, I think is the best-selling American poetry book of the 20th century, if not attaching the two circumstances, but it'd be nice. Anyway, so young poet of Long Island, and she has published quite a bit in journals, but as I said, she's been having, you know, this very successful literary fiction career, so it stands alone right now in my second bankruptcy book, and Carol will come up and I'll just stay up here.
Thank you. I feel very abashed to be reading in this audience of, well, in this company of Ginger and Lee, because Lee's being too kind to call me a poet. I haven't written poetry for quite a few years, but I did have a renaissance of writing poetry right around the time I met Lee. And one of the poems I wrote during that time was in memory of the junior year abroad I spent in Rome. And so this is dedicated to students studying abroad and the experiences you have when you're doing that. It's called The Sycamores of Rome. The sycamore's bark peels in the delicate shades of Quattrocento fresco. One tree's trunk is as pale as honeydew rind, scraped in places to reveal the watery green fruit inside. They remind you of the sycamores in Rome and how their leaves swirled in the dusk-bright Tiber and papered the rain-corroded haunches of Garibaldi's horse in the park at the top of the Janiculum, where women, still soft-eyed from siesta, strolled arm in arm above the many-breasted city. You could compare the color of their leaves to the bricks that wall the road uncoiling down the hill, or the rust dusting slim hips of boys tilting backwards in fountains. But what you remember is a single arrow of sun shooting through Latin class to strike the studiously bent head of your fellow scholar, setting dull brown hair into flames of Titian red, so that you stumbled over your Virgil translation, losing the measure of your own heart's beat. The next day, you crested the hill on your way to mail a letter at the Vatican and found that the bronze-clad sky had split open to let in the Apennines, standing sentinel above the winter besieged city. On your last morning, you went back to the park on top of the hill, but weather had already done what failing memory never would, wound the thick white wool of fog like a sheet tangled in sleep-sprawled limbs around the achingly fine bones of your lost beloved city. Thank you.
So I want to finish with two poems, and first I will find them, then I will finish with them. But so this is, I published another book last summer called Red-Tailed Hawk on Wall Street, and it has some poems about Wall Street in it, but as few as possible, to be honest. And this one, it's the first poem in the book. It's called Mid-Bronx, 8 a.m. Who knows when happy first became a verb? I do recall the first place that I heard it used this way, a crowded subway car, mid-Bronx, mid-May. A teen addressed his love, "You happy me," caressing her red hair at one of those mysterious long stops in tunnel blackness. Braiding her hair in loops, he kissed her then, as if to prove his passion knew few bounds. Then lights went out, a louder kiss, the train rolled slightly back. Some PA static roared wordless. No doubt a rush hour crowd like this heading to work was not about to panic. Then we heard an older woman's voice almost a shout, "Train, happy us and move." So language spreads. And I'm going to dedicate this last poem, which is 4 days old, to Ginger, because, you know, I've run across, I mean, she has, of course, a lot of talent, but just as I said earlier, I mean, the connection between philosophy and poetry is not, you know, I can't speak for a lot of other national, you know, cultures, which I'm ignorant of, where there may be really a strong tradition, you know, but certainly, and there are many poets, of course, who had a very philosophical orientation in their work, and probably almost all do to some degree, but I think, for example, of Robinson Jeffers, who probably the most misanthropic poet in American history, certainly was, you know, very much aware of issues, you know, like human survival and evolution, as was Edna St. Vincent Millay, which to me has always been an incredibly ignored aspect of her poetic legacy. I mean, J.D. McClatchy, who's the editor of the Yale Review, wrote a book which really gave it full exposure, but, you know, it seemed to get... And there's a long list of other poets, so I don't want to say that no poets write about philosophy, but, you know, I was very much taken to this orientation in Ginger's work because I just run across it very rarely, and because it has so much to do with really deep understanding of Greek history. In the period in which, going back to the previous poem, in which there were rumors, like you could say rumors might occur today about Madonna or Putin, there were rumors that Pythagoras had traveled to India 700 years before and met Zoroaster, who was the, you know, prophet of Zoroastrianism. So this is an imaginary, this is a dialogue from that meeting. And in this dialogue, we have Zoroaster with the light and dark. And we have Pythagoras making various references to the number one, which also I think came up in Ginger's reading. And you could not overstate again how important the issue of the number one and unity was in that period, you know, that middle period of the millennia, you know, before Christianity, where all of this philosophy was really being formulated. So it's called Fractions and Arcs. When Zoroaster mentioned that the tide, both high and low, implied a moral war, Pythagoras observed a gull to soar above the foamy tumult and replied, "My thoughts on light and dark cannot involve meanderings and rhythms. Primal one, in fact, is two.
Our challenges revolve around the dark's relentlessness. The sun does not illumine half's bleak, constant night. Then Zoroaster's face grew sorrowful. You mean there's no kingdom of the light, no final victory? They watched the gull. Her answer was not theorems, but to swerve towards sunset in a slow ascending curve. Okay, thank you very much. Should I say anything else, or do you want to say something? Or does anyone want to say something?
I would like to say something because I appreciate so much the work that both these poets do and the honor we have of having poetry readings. Ginger has read several times, and now Lee has been here three times.
We read twice and one time. So.
That's all right. It was like a poem, no doubt. If a crisis could be considered a poem. Anyway, I want to thank you all as well for coming, especially my students from Central Michigan University who have all come, and I think they appreciated Caroline's poetry about a study abroad experience especially. But all the rest was also inspiring to me, certainly. Thank you so much. And now we would like to invite you all to come outside and speak to the poets and have a glass of wine and perhaps something snacky to eat.